Energy. We all need it.
To light and heat our homes.
To cook our food.
To keep our food cold.
Power our cities. Transport goods.
To make all the goods we're transporting.
To go to work. To go on vacation.
To develop the next big thing.
Heck, you're using it right now watching this video on your laptop or smartphone or smart TV. Maybe all three at the same time because you're weird like that.
If you are, it helps prove a point.
The world's population is growing. People are moving from the country into cities, entering the middle class, starting to live more like you and me.
Hopefully these up-and-coming consumers learn from our mistakes. But we can't ask them to not buy a washing machine and keep scrubbing their undies by hand, just to slow down rising energy needs as we enjoy the second screen experience in our air-conditioned condo with floor-to-ceiling windows.
The IEA says world energy consumption will increase by 31% by 2040.
Where are we going to get all that energy?
Well, it comes in many forms, and each has its pros and cons. We started off with wood, animal fats, and dried poop. And these are still relied on in many places around the world. Yes, even poop.
Then somewhere along the way, we discovered the fossil fuel trio: coal, oil, and natural gas.
Developing ways to take advantage of coal's high-intensity energy accelerated the Industrial Revolution, which led to civilization as we know it. But coal has the highest carbon emissions of all fossil fuels, so it has been declining in popularity for power generation.
Unlike other energy resources, crude oil and natural gas are used for much more than simply fuels and electricity generation. And today, their byproducts are used to make pretty much everything around you. Originally, oil was mainly refined to produce kerosene, an energy source for lighting and heating.
And now a primary ingredient in liquid rocket fuel.
Bringing this discussion back down to Earth, the burning of oil-derived fuels is a primary source of GHG emissions, and production displaces flora and fauna. Natural gas is a versatile and widely used energy source. It is the cleanest burning of the fossil fuels and has a smaller production footprint. However, the fracking process used to recover natural gas trapped in rock deep underground requires large quantities of water.
Speaking of water, harnessing hydro turned deserts into fields and led to zero emissions electricity generation. But dammed rivers create reservoirs that consume forests and other vegetation, which release GHG emissions of their own while permanently displacing people and wildlife.
Nuclear promised clean energy, but because original reactor technology was designed to produce weapons-grade plutonium as a byproduct to offset high construction costs, it's not as fail-safe as it could have been.
So that takes us to renewable energy. Here we're usually talking about solar and wind, but these green solutions are not without their own unintended consequences.
Like the large areas of land required to produce enough energy, which then displaces and alters surrounding ecosystems, killing birds and bats, and the water required to clean solar panels.
Oh wait, we almost forgot fusion. On the brink of success since, 1982. But that's a whole other story.
Canada's pretty lucky when it comes to energy. We produce a lot of it across all the types mentioned, plus a few more. Combined, we have more than any other country in the world. So we're set, right?
Wrong.
Just like our population, Canada's amazing energy resources are not split evenly across provinces and territories.
And the places where energy sources are most abundant are not the same places with the most demand. To diversify energy sources and be more self-sufficient regionally, everyone is working to increase their use of renewable energy, including wind, solar, biomass, and geothermal.
These renewables are the logical way to grow low-carbon-emitting energy, and the production technologies are advancing. But they aren't keeping up with the demand in the same steady way as hydro and fossil fuels, nor can they power and produce everything we need them to. So expect to see all forms of energy in the mix for the foreseeable future.
Now, how do we get all that energy to where it is needed all around the world?
Well, we can't. At least not yet. Think of energy transmission like a railroad. Tracks allow trains to move goods across the country. But when the railway ends, we have to find other forms of transportation to get them to the next destination.
Just like we don't have train tracks crossing oceans, we currently don't have a way to transport electricity overseas. So, unless connected to a shared electrical grid, when we're talking about trading energy, we're talking about fossil fuels, plus a bit of uranium.
Since oil is still the primary energy source bought and sold around the world, let's look at where it comes from.
Globally, the top 10 oil reserves are Venezuela,
Saudi Arabia,
Canada,
Iran,
Iraq,
Kuwait,
Russia,
United Arab Emirates,
Libya,
Nigeria,
and the United States.
But just like there are pros and cons to the different kinds of energy, there are pros and cons to where it comes from. Once we rule out dictators, self-serving royals, pirates, bullies, warring nations, human rights violators, regulatory shortfalls, and protectionist policies.
Canada is politically stable, has some of the strictest environmental regulations and most responsible producers in the world, and is a leader in industry innovation.
Before we get too carried away about Canada's polite energy saving the world, let's take a look at ourselves in the mirror. Although Canada produces a lot of energy, we're good at getting it from here to here, but we're not so good at getting it from here to here. So we buy it from a lot of other places.
Like here, here, and here. Here, and here.
That last trade relationship gets a little convoluted, since the United States is currently the only customer we have for our primary energy exports. And since the recent viability of shale oil and shale natural gas reserves, our single buyer is now a seller.
To Canada.
So we need more than one customer.
What about Canada?
How can we sell to ourselves?
Instead of buying oil and natural gas from other people, about $13.9 billion worth every year, wouldn't it be better to use our own and then sell what we don't need to growing countries like China and India?
Of course it would.
And yes, it's not as easy as simply throwing an ad up on eBay and shipping it overseas by Canada Post.
We still need to do some work at home before we're ready to sell to new markets, helping growing countries provide the energy they need to meet the growing energy demands of their growing middle class, and in a more sustainable manner than they can do with their own local resources.
So we should start now.
In the meantime, we should at least become more aware of how energy is used and moved all around us and around the world.
And a good place to start is understanding how much energy we use to power our own lives at home.
Are you an efficiency superstar or energy superuser? Follow the link provided to take a quick survey and find out.
It will take less than half the time you just spent listening to us.